Okay, so yesterday we started with rest of hypothesis for proportion for one sample, and you know we know that z is nothing but p minus p naught by p q by n, square root of p q by n. So here actually, this, if you remember, we got this from the same z, which is x bar minus mu by sigma by root n. But in when you are talking about proportion, we know that the proportions are only about the binomial distribution. So for binomial distribution, mu is nothing but pq. So it is going to be p naught q naught. P naught q naught means it is about the population proportion, by sigma is pq by n. Okay, so based on this we got the formula for, we divided the numerator and denominator by n, and we got this formula. Is that okay? So based on this, we got the formula for z in terms of p and p naught, not in terms of the other values, not in terms of x bar and mu and all those things. So based on that, we got proportion for population. I'm sorry. Population proportion as well as sample proportion. And you know, p naught is the population proportion. So p naught we substituted using the h naught, and p is nothing but the sample proportion. That's what we got it from. Let me remove this unnecessary things. Is that clear, Abid? How we got this formula? Yeah, I think we derived earlier.
Yeah, we did.
That's why I'm not doing the full derivation. We can do the full derivation.
Yeah, it makes sense. And I got it.
So p naught we got it from the mu, and p we get it from the x bar.
If we
divide by, you know, n on both the sides, this is population proportion, this is sample proportion. That's how we got it.
Okay.
Now based on that, we started our discussion on the test of hypothesis for proportion. So if we have to do the test of hypothesis for proportion, we have to again find out the null hypothesis and alternate hypothesis. For one of the problem, we found out this as our hypothesis, and we substituted the value for p naught using the h naught. So it is 0.01. So p naught is null hypothesis is going to be your population proportion value. So based on the null hypothesis, you have to substitute every time, the same logic. Okay, when you substitute the values, null hypothesis is having 0.01. from our data, we took a data of test cases. 1000 test cases are present. So out of 1000 test cases, we got a proportion of 0.094. And based on this, we got a Z calc of 9.1. Now you can see in your Z tab is always based on the alpha. Alpha, if it is 5%, 1.64 is the Z tab. This we got it from the Python. And z calc, if we substitute all the values, we got 9.10. so anything about 1.64 is going to be in the rejection region, so we are going to reject null hypothesis. Okay, the same logic.
Yes, Sandeep.
Every time there will be the same logic. Then the second thing we discussed about is the test of hypothesis for variance. Now here we started with the manufacturing of gears. So when we are developing some gears are automobile basic parts in the automobile, right? So gear is nothing but it is a circular one which will have some this kind of tooth. So what we are doing here is the gear, the diameter of the gear is very important because the speed of the vehicle will be determined by the diameter of the gear. So if we have too much of variance in the gears when you are manufacturing the gears, then your manufacturing unit itself is wrong, I mean is having some problems, you have to go and fix it. So what we are testing here is the variance in the diameter of the gear. So again, the null and alternative hypothesis is variance should not be large. Here I am defining large variance as nothing but 0.01. Anything above that or below that is too much of variance. So using that, when we are talking about any variance, we should be talking about chi-square distribution. So this is nothing but chi-square distribution. Chi is a, the symbol for chi is very similar to x, just you should have some curves while writing the x. So chi-square distribution is what we have to use when you have something like this, when you want to test for variance. So again, we have to define some alpha. Here also I have defined the alpha as 5%. But since my alternative hypothesis is not equal to, I should do a two-sided test. So using that, I try to get the two-sided test, which is chi-square alpha by 2, which is at this point, and chi-square 1 minus alpha by 2, which is at this point. So using those two values and using the chi-square calc as well, chi-square calc is nothing but n minus 1 into s square by sigma square. Using this formula as well, we can go and find out the chi-square calc. Now this calc value is present outside of these two values. It's not between these two values. It's outside of these two values, which means it is a rejection region. 0.039 is outside of 73 and 128. So that's why we are going to take a value, that's why we are going to reject the null hypothesis. Are you clear so far?
Yes, Sandeep.
Yes.
Generally, if it is our values lies in the red region, then only we have to reject the hypothesis.
Yes, that's how it is, right? So 73 is this value.
Okay.
73 is this one. So it will be here. Hmm. And 128 will be somewhere here.
Okay. Our output answer is?
Our chi-square calc is 0.3929, which is in this region, right?
In the red region. Okay, sure.
Yes. I'm just telling you in a different way. This is not between these two values.
Yeah, that's what I got.
This value is not between these two values. Without even, drawing a picture.
You got this chi-square alpha by 2 and chi-square 1 minus alpha by 2 values from Python scripts, right?
Yes, I got it from there.
Okay, all right.
Okay. So that's what we have discussed yesterday. Any questions so far?
Sandeep, we should say that the value is between this value in this red region. No?
Suppose yes. Yes.
But you are saying that this value is
between these two values. I said this chi-square calc is not between these two values. If it is not between these two values, it is in the red region, right?
Yeah. Okay. Got it. Yes.
That's what I was saying.
Got it, Sandeep. Sorry.
Yeah. So that's about the one sample t-test, one sample test. So all we did till now is we took one sample data, and from that sample we tried to test some hypothesis. But the question is, what happens if I want to test two samples. Okay, now you may ask me what is the reason why I should use two samples versus one sample. So it depends on the problem to problem. But in this case, when you are testing two samples, it means that there are two different populations. So there is a population one and population two. So from population one, you take sample one, and from population two, you took sample two. Now you want to test if these two samples are having the same mu or not, or same P naught or not. So did you get the idea? So we have two different samples. From these two samples, I want to know or understand, are these two samples having the same population parameters? Or can we compare, for example, is mu 1 from this sample 1 is greater than mu 2 from sample 2? Now, why do we want to do this? Is like this. So for example, let's say there is a employee that who went to training. Now this employee, before his training, his performance is, for example, we can take the support tickets example itself. Let me write that. Two sample test of hypothesis. So you have, an employee who is resolving, again, the same support ticket example. Support tickets. Let me give you some hypothetical case where there is, so this employee went for a training. Before training, his performance is recorded. After training also, his performance is recorded. Let me write some data and give you some insight. So before training, so his performance is, let's say, first day he resolved 15 tickets. Second day he resolved 12 tickets, then he resolved 18 tickets, then he resolved, let's say, 14 tickets. This is his performance before the training. Now let's say after the training, we again recorded his support ticket performance. I mean, how many tickets he is going to resolve. First day he resolved 20 tickets, second day 10 tickets, third day let's say 18 tickets, again 12 tickets, 10 tickets, then again 20 tickets. It doesn't need to be the same number of samples, because this is a different sample, this is a different sample. So the size of the sample doesn't matter, it can be varying. Here it is 4, here it is 8, or here it is 6. It doesn't matter. You can still have different sizes of samples, but still this procedure works. Now let's say this is the data that you have. Can anyone tell, is his performance improved or not? Any comments on this data, based on this data? Let's say, let me change it a little. Let's say this is 14, this is 16, and let's say this is 15. So any comments on this data, how this data is looking? Is his performance improved after training, or what are the inferences that you can take without even statistics, just by looking at the data?
There is no relation between before training and after training, Sandeep.
There is no relation, meaning there is something changed, right?
at least maximum tickets he is resolving is increased.
Increased. Then any other inferences? Can you think in terms of the parameters that we are testing in till now, mu, sigma square, p naught?
I think variance is more after training.
Yeah, here there is a more variance. More variance. Right? Any other things? I think average is also increased. Can you calculate quickly? Let's do that from here. Before training and after training. Okay, 15, 14,
16, 15.
16 and 15. Now 20, 10, 18, 12. 20, 10, 18, 12.
And 10, 20.
10, 20. So what about the averages?
Here it is 16. Oh, yeah. Before training is 15.
Is it 15? Yeah, 15.
Yes, I'm
right. And here it is. Still 15. Okay. Sample averages are 15, 15. No difference. Interesting, right? Now my question is his performance better here or better here? Averages are same. What about the standard deviations or variance? I think where dot s, yeah. See, averages are same, but his variance is different. Actually, it is completely different. Variance is completely different, right? There is no the variance before the training and after the training, there is no comparison. So this is the reason why I always tell, do not look always at the averages. Okay, looking at averages will only help you half the part, especially sample averages. You are not even talking about the population average, right? Whatever sample you have, that sample average you are talking about here. So for whatever six observations that you have, for those six observations we took an average of 15. We do not know yet how many, what is the average of the population. We know only about the average of the sample. Similarly, here also we collected only 4 days data. Based on that, we are saying the average is 15. We do not know the population average. So unless we talk about the population average, we cannot say these two averages are same or not. Are you clear why I'm saying this? The second thing is, just because averages are same, even if it is population average, do not say that those two data elements are same. Okay, those two samples are same. Do not say that. You have to look at the variance also. Actually, after his training, his performance, I would say, based on these only sample parameters. I'm not talking about the population right now. Based on only this sample data, I would say his performance has degraded. It did not increase. Why? Any answer? Why I would say his performance degraded? Based on only sample parameters. I did not still talk about the population.
Actually, from the average, it is deviating too much. So, at least before training, he is near to the average.
Yes.
Support tickets he is resolving. but here from the average it is deviating more, so he is decreasing, increasing and decreasing, both are there.
Yes, so here actually in a way I can say his performance is not consistent after training. He do not have consistency in his performance after training. Can I say that?
Yes.
So his consistency is gone. So earlier, he is almost approximately close to 15, which is average. You can see from here, first day he is 15, which is equal to average. Second day, very close to average. Third day also very close to average. Fourth day also very close to average. So his consistency is good here. Now here, one day he is resolving 20. Then suddenly he is decreasing to 10. Again he is increasing to 18. Then 12. So you can see his his performance is varying widely. That's what variance is capturing, right? Variance is capturing how much you are deviating from the center. Center is nothing but my X bar, which is 15. From 15, it is varying widely. That's why you are having a variance, a large variance. Here, it's not much. You're not varying that much. So just because X bars are same, do not say these two performances are same. This is a naive way of thinking, because many people will think if average is same, data is same. No, data is not same. Only if averages are same, the two population averages, as well as population standard deviations are same or population variances are same, both mu and sigma are same, then you can say data is similar. Do not say that just because averages are same, that two sample averages are same, do not say that these two data are same. Are you clear with this example why I was saying both average and standard deviation are very important?
Yes, Sandeep.
Got it.
So without these two things, do not conclude that your data is same. For example, one and let's say three. What is the average?
Two.
Two.
So averages are same. Can you say these two are same?
No.
You cannot say, obviously. But that's what we are, we are taught initially. If you are, it's not taught. That's a general perception for everyone. If averages are same, you can say, okay, this average is same as that average. So it's fine. Both are same. For example, tomorrow you might do some performance improvement to any of your jobs. Okay, after improving the performance also, your averages are same, let's say. Can you say that average is, for example, before improving the performance, jobs are taking on average 15 minutes. After improving, again the average is 15 minutes. Can you say that performance is not improved? You should not say. You should say by taking into account also the variance. For example, averages are same, but variance decreased after the performance improvement. What do you say? You have improved the performance still. Are you clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so that's how you should think. You should not think on the averages. You should think on both average as well as variance. That too, not about the sample averages. Only talk about the population averages. Okay. Here also, till now I'm talking about only sample averages. Actually, I should not be talking about sample averages, right? I should be talking about if mu 1 equal to mu 2 or not. That's what is my intention of doing two sample test. So in two sample test, 2 sample mean test. So 2 sample test again has mean test, variance test, all those tests, proportion test, all those 3 tests. So when we are talking about 2 sample mean test, we are talking about H1 either as mu1 not equal to mu2, then what will H0 will become? Mu1 equal to
mu2.
There could be other possibility also where mu1 greater than mu2, right? In which case this will become mu1 less than or equal to mu2. The third alternative that you can have in testing two sample mean test is mu1 less than mu2. These are the only tests, right? That's what you can do.
Yes, Sandeep.
So using two sample mean test, you can either say if mu1 is equal to mu2 or mu1 greater than mu2 or less than mu2. All these things we can try to test, because this came from a different population. This came from a different population. When I say it came from a different population, it means that it has different characteristics of population parameters. Meaning it has different mu, different sigma square. This also has a different mu, different sigma square. If those two parameters are different, it came from a different normal distribution. Right? Are you clear so far? Any questions over why they came from two different populations?
No, Sandeep, fine.
Yes, Sandeep.
Okay. Now you know earlier that ZX bar. What is it? X bar?
Minus mu by sigma.
Sigma by root n, not sigma.
Yes, sir.
Okay. This is what we know earlier. Can I write this as X bar minus E of X? E of X is nothing but mu, right? E of x bar by variance of x bar under root. I can write, right? Why? Because E of x bar is nothing but mu. E of x bar equal to E of x equal to mu, and V of x bar equal to V of x by square root of n, which is equal to sigma square by V of square root will not be there. Sigma square by n. If you take it under root, you will get sigma by root n. Right? Any questions on this? This is from the sampling distribution, if you remember.
Yes, Sandeep.
Now, what? Yeah, one more thing I should tell is, can I write this H0s as mu1 minus mu2 equal to 0 instead of this? Similarly, this one also as mu1 minus mu2 not equal to 0. I can write, right?
Yes, Sandeep.
So what it means is, instead of saying both the averages are same, both the population averages are same, I am saying the difference of population averages is equal to 0 as H0. Similarly, as H1, what I am saying, the difference of mu's are not equal to 0. What I am saying is, instead of talking about equality of two mu's, I am talking as talking about them as difference between two mu's. Right? So instead of talking about as this mu 1 equal to mu 2, I will now talk about differences. I can do that, right? Just if you take this mu on the left side, you will get mu 1 minus mu 2. So I will be talking about, instead of talking about z mu 1 and z mu 2, I'll talk about z x bar minus x1 bar minus x2 bar. Why? Because difference of mu's is what I am interested in. On sample parameters, it is nothing but difference of x bars. So for difference of x bars, how do we get it? I just substitute, instead of x bar, I'll substitute x1 bar minus x2 bar. Similarly, here also I'll substitute e of x1 bar minus x2 bar by square root of e of x1 bar minus x2 bar. Can I do this?
Yes, Sandeep.
So instead of talking about one sample, I'm talking now about the two samples. And instead of talking about equality of two mu's, I'm talking about the difference of mu's. Now, this is nothing but x1 bar minus x2 bar minus what is e of x1, e of x plus or minus e of y. E of x plus or minus y. It is nothing but e of x plus or minus e of y. That's what we learned earlier. Can I do this as e of x1 bar minus e of x2 bar? Using just this formula. Similarly, variance of variance of x plus or minus y. Do you remember the formula?
Variance of x plus variance of y minus covariance of x comma y.
Plus or minus 2 times of covariance of xy. X comma y. Okay. It's plus or minus. But here, what is x and what is y? X is x1 bar. Y is x2 bar.
Two different samples.
Two different samples. They are independent, right?
Yes, on the
covariance. Independent means covariance, we can assume it is zero. Right? They're independent. I don't know about this value. I mean, this value is different from this value. Okay? There is no dependency on this one to this one. So they're independent. So what I can do is I can remove that covariance term. It will become v of x1 bar plus v of x2 bar. Now what is e of x1 bar and what is e of x2 bar? This is mu 1, this is mu 2. So can I write this as x1 bar minus x2 bar minus mu 1 minus mu 2 by square root of v of x1 bar, what is it? Sigma 1 square by n plus this is sigma 2 square by n. Is that right? That's what we wrote. Sigma square by n. Instead of I am writing sigma 1 square by n, sigma 2. So that is your z for two sample mean test. Okay. Any questions on this? How we got this formula?
I'm good, Sandeep.
Okay. Again, we have the same problems. What is mu? First thing, what is mu 1 and mu 2? Second thing is, how do we get the sigma 1, sigma 2? Right? Because sigma 1 and sigma 2 are population standard deviations or population variances. Mu 1 and mu 2 are population averages. And in general, we don't know either this or this. Both of them we don't know, right? Neither we know this, neither we know, nor we know this. But mu 1 and mu 2, what we did in the one sample average test. We substituted that with the value of the H naught, right? So instead of mu, we substituted 15. What is 15? 15 is the value that you find in the H naught. So for mu 1 and mu 2 also, we can do the same thing. But here, mu 1 minus mu 2 is 0. Right? That's what we know. We know that mu 1 equal to mu 2. Sorry, mu 1 minus mu 2 equal to 0 under H naught. So always you have to substitute the mu 1 and mu 2 using H naught only. Whichever parameter we are estimating, that parameter we have to use, we have to substitute using H naught. So under H naught, what is Z? X1 bar minus X2 bar. This will become 0 because under H naught, mu 1 equal to mu 2. And that happens for everything. For example, here also, mu 1 minus mu 2 less than or equal to 0. Again, we can replace mu 1 minus mu 2 as 0. And here also same thing, mu 1 minus mu 2 greater than or equal to, 1 second, 0. Again, mu 1 minus mu 2 you can replace with 0. Always you are replacing mu with the H naught value. So here the under H naught, we get mu 1 minus mu 2 as 0. So instead of writing this big formula, I can write x1 bar minus x2 bar by square root of sigma 1 square by n plus sigma 2 square by n. This is what we are going to use for test of hypothesis. Are you clear so far? Any questions so far?
Sandeep, in the second case and third case, it is like either less than or equal to and greater than or equal to, but it is not exactly.
There is an equal to, right?
Yeah, equal.
Whichever the value is equal, that value you can substitute.
Okay.
Okay. The equality value is what we are interested in actually. Because you are assuming, let's say this is your mu. If this is the equality value, we are talking about something above this, right? For example, if greater than is your H naught, less than will be your H1, right? Which means it is a one-sided test, left-sided test.
Yes.
So we are interested in anything mu, let's say this is mu 1 minus mu 2. I'll give you a brief idea about it. Mu 1 minus mu 2 now is this median value, this middle value. Okay. Now we are interested in anything above this mu 1 minus mu 2 under H naught. Under H naught, we are interested in this one, right? If we have to accept H naught, anything greater than mu 1 minus mu 2 greater than 0, because this one will be 0, right? Mu 1 minus mu 2 equal to 0 actually, okay, in normal distribution, right?
Yeah.
So anything above this is what we are interested in.
Yeah.
But what we do in test of hypothesis is not a, we won't take exactly greater than or greater than this value. We'll give some lenience. We are lenient actually. We give this part also as an accepted region because we may not have the proper sample. So we give some more extra space, extra buffer. This is your buffer region. This extra buffer region also will give as an accepted region, after which we'll start rejecting. That's what it is. It means by using this normal distribution for test of hypothesis. That's what it means by saying this is acceptance region. The acceptance region we got because the right side of this line is always accepted. That is clear because that is a mean value, mu1 minus mu2. If you are drawing a mu1 minus mu2 curve, the middle value will be mu1 minus mu2, which is equal to 0. Anything above this is acceptance region, which is clear, right? Accepting H0. Are you clear or not? But we give another buffer, some more buffer on the left side also, because we may not have the entire sample, the proper sample. So we give extra buffer for accepting H0, after which we'll start rejecting everything. Anything even less than this value, we'll start rejecting. Are you clear with this explanation? Are you there, Subha?
Yeah.
Are you convinced or you're not convinced?
Yeah, convinced.
So, because we don't have the exact values, what we do is we give extra buffer for accepting H0. In a way, we are trying as much as possible to accept H0. But after some point, we start rejecting H0, which is this red region. So, that's how we do. That's why this mu1 minus mu2, it starts from 0. Okay? That's why we substitute, actually. I can give better explanation, but I don't want to give too much of explanation. Last time I gave only one full class on this one only.
So, Sandeep, I have a question.
Yeah.
So how does it relate to, suppose we take the loan data set, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So we have different samples for different data set. How can you compare the data mu1 and mu2 in that case?
Okay, good question. I'll give you that. One second. Your question is where are two samples in that case?
Yeah, because I want to understand. You said the right buffer I understood, but the left buffer I'm not convinced. That extra buffer you said I'm not convinced. I mean, I don't understand, so basically. Let's put it that way.
Okay. One second. Let me... Where is your data set? Is it in Python? Okay. I think I should clean up your drive. It's distributed. The data sets are distributed. So I'll keep it at one place. So your question is, I think your question has two parts. One part of your question is, where do we have two samples? For example, application income, we have only one sample, one mu. Where do we have two mu's? Mu1 and mu2.
Yeah.
And your second question is about the buffer. Buffer I am going to answer separately. Okay?
Okay.
Just remember that once we are, at some level after ANOVA, we'll take one extra class of understanding these things. How test of hypothesis actually works. Right now, what I gave you is a mechanical way of solving the problem. Right?
Yeah.
I gave you steps. Based on the steps, go to the step and solve the problem. But I agree that I did not give you the proper reasoning. But we'll park it there because what I wanted to do is let's complete the syllabus as much as possible. Then whenever we get some extra time, we'll try to understand some more deeply. Is that fine?
Okay, that's fine, Sandeep. Yeah.
Okay. Now, because our main purpose is understanding how to apply on the real data.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you can answer the second part. The buffer part, maybe you can understand.
So, buffer part, I'll explain later. But now, the first part of the question is, where do we get two samples? So, for example, yesterday I told you on applicant income, I can do one sample test on mu. So, for example, I can do a test on. Can I do like this on applicant income? Let me write H1 first. Income, let's say I am expecting from this data, let me take a sample average. Sample average is saying 5,400. So let me expect, so my expectation is income, average income, let me keep it as a bar, greater than 5,000 is my expectation. Okay, the reverse of it is going to be H0. Now, what I am doing here is, I am just doing a one sample test. I am not doing a two sample test. Now, where do I have the second sample? If you see this column individually, you'll definitely find only one sample. You'll never find a two samples. But if you consider this entire data set as a whole, and consider applicant income, where does it fit in, then you can find the those two samples. For example, can I ask you one question? Is graduate income versus non-graduate average income, will it be same, or will it be some from the same population? First of all,
be from the same population. Yes,
different populations, so there will be different averages.
But from this data set, it is the same population, right, Sandeep? Why would it be different population?
So the question is, so the definition of population I have given once, if you remember. Let me go back to that. So there is the definition of, the understanding of population is very important. So population is the probability distribution of any random variable. To define a particular population, it's sufficient to define the parameters of the distribution. Okay, what I'm saying is every population will have a different distribution, and that distribution will have different parameters. So for example, if I say graduate income and non-graduate income are going to be on normal distribution, it's not sufficient. What I said is sufficient is, it's sufficient to define the parameters of the distribution. For example, if graduate mu equal to, let's say, $6,000, and non-graduate mu, when I say mu, it is a mu of the applicant income, average of this, population averages of this applicant income. So okay, if you take the non-graduate mu, it might be different. It might be same also. Okay, there are two cases. Either it can be same or it can or cannot be same. Those are the only two cases.
True.
So assuming that these two are different mu's, then they came from a different population.
Yeah.
Because the parameter of the distribution is different. Mu and sigma are your normal distribution parameters.
Yeah.
So if mu is different, obviously the distribution is different.
True. Hence the population is different. Okay, got it.
Right? Now, if you combine this education versus applicant income, then you are going to see two different populations. In fact, sometimes you may see more than two populations, right? Maybe some, let's say this is postgraduate, graduate, and non-graduate. Then there are three populations.
True.
So as and when you find any categorical data and a continuous data, you can find multiple samples. That is the idea.
Okay, got it.
Okay. Are you clear, Zahir?
Yeah, I'm clear, Sandeep.
Okay, similarly, same thing with gender. Maybe, there is a gender discrimination and, male applicant income is greater than female applicant income. Generally, that happens in many countries. Right? Yeah. similarly, you know, it might happen, I don't know if married and applicant income are related, but it might happen like property area. You know, if you are living in rural area, then it might happen that your applicant income is low. Or it might also happen that he is applying for a rural area, but he is working in an urban area. I don't know. So these things I have to test. Is it really what I am thinking or is it different? That is the reason why I'm, you know, why we are going through this test of hypothesis and all those things. So your assumptions are different from the actual reality. So the reality may be different. For example, it might happen that non-graduates are earning more than graduates. It might happen from the data. So your assumption is one thing, but the second thing you have to do is you have to go and test your assumptions. That's where test of hypothesis comes into picture. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's what, so when you have to understand your data, whichever data set it is, I don't care which data set it is. First thing you have to do is understand the data using test of hypothesis. Of course, you will have sample averages, all those things. But again, that's what we discussed, right? So sample averages are not going to give you the real picture about the population. Tomorrow, some other you know, person might come, or some other data set might come, some 10 more records in this, 10 more observations in this data. And we should consider those also, future data set also. So to consider the future data set, we should not just talk about this only 100 or how many it is, some 500, I believe. Yeah, 615. We should not only talk about the 615 observations. We should talk about the entire data set, even for the future data set. Maybe tomorrow there may be 40 more new applicants for the loan. I should talk about those 40 also.
That is correct. But in the right now, after you simplified the formula where mu 1 equal to minus mu 2 equal to 0. So what you've written on the right side, the population mean will be the sample mean here. X1 bar will be say 6,000 minus 4,000, correct?
That's my assumption based on the H0. I'm testing if that assumption is correct or not. That's why under H0, this is only under H0. The actual formula is this one. But okay. Under H0 means based on our assumptions, we don't need this part. Based on as assumptions, we don't need this part. Then we calculated Z based on that. Okay?
Okay.
That's what we did earlier also. If you see here also, even for sigma square equal to 0.01, sigma square not equal to 0.01, what did we substitute with sigma square? 0.01. That's what we did from the beginning. Now what I am doing is because mu 1 minus mu 2 equal to 0, I am just removing it from the formula. That's it. That's what I am doing.
Yeah. But that is an assumption, right?
That is only under assumption under H0. This formula holds good only as long as H0 holds good. Now, based on the Z, I will say whether or not to accept H0 or not, right?
Yeah.
That's why, so my final decision is on which hypothesis. My final decision is on H0. So this Z, this is nothing but Z tab, right? Z calc.
No, I'm just trying to relate the formula to the data set or something. That's the part I'm trying to.
Yeah, build. We'll go to that. We'll go to that. We'll try to solve these problems finally.
Okay.
Okay. So that's what I was saying. I did not want to go too much into theory this time. I think last time I mentioned all these technical details. Actually, this is N1 and N2. Sorry. So all these details I have mentioned, if you go back and verify your notes or whatever, I have explained why exactly this test of hypothesis works. If you can remember. So there I mentioned why we have to give an extra lenience this is the whatever I mentioned. If this is a mu, for example, if H naught and H1, let's say H1 is mu greater than 10 and H1 H naught is mu less than or equal to 10. So if this is a mu, which generally in normal distribution, in standard Z distribution, this is going to be zero. So we are always testing from this angle, right?
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Under H naught, what are we interested in? Under H naught, we are interested in accepting this region. This part is always clear. Anything less than mu is what we want to accept. But we do not have the entire data. We do not have the proper data. So we have to give some extra buffer for accepting H naught. This is your buffer region. After that buffer region also, then you start rejecting H naught. Reject H naught. Now this rejection region is always based on the, generally what I told you initially, always have a rejection region based on the H1. Is that correct? The same thing I am getting, but I am just explaining in a different way. So this extra buffer is what I am giving because my sample is not proper. My sample may not cover all the scenarios, right? My sample may not cover all scenarios. Because my sample may not cover all the scenarios, I'm not just giving anything, I'm not accepting anything exactly less than 10, but I am accepting this extra region as well. Okay, that is dependent on this alpha. The more the alpha, the less this buffer. Are you clear?
I'm okay, Sandeep.
Okay. I think we don't want to go into very much technical details because, you know, all we mostly want is understanding how to solve this kind of problems. That should be our emphasis. That's what I believe. But I can take one class, separate class, and explain if you want. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. But that we'll try to avoid as much as possible until the end. Maybe at the end we'll try to understand these problems, these technical details. End of the course. That way we'll complete the course as quickly as possible. Then we'll understand some theoretical aspects. Why did we do like that? Is there any reason for doing this kind of test? All those things. Okay. So that's what I have. So I think it is a break time, but it's just thinking what to do. It's neither break time nor. Okay. What we can do is we can stop the class today. Okay, understand what I talked about today, how this mu1 minus mu2 will be zero under H naught, and understand what is a two sample test. For the most important part is what is two sample test, how will we use it in reality. In reality it is very simple. You have to just split on one of the categorical column and get two different continuous samples. Based on that, you can do all kinds of analysis that you want. Is this clear?
Yes, Sandeep.
Yeah. For example, credit history. Credit history, I can do a proportion test, right? Percentage of sample data that you have that the credit history is greater than, let's say, P naught is my P naught greater than 10%. I can do a test on this. But again, if I want to do a two sample proportion test, I can do a split on education. Is my proportion of credit history, is the proportion of graduate credits, credit history is greater than proportion of non-graduates. What it means is, are graduates repaying the loan properly compared to non-graduates? Based on that, you can finally give a loan status, right? If the graduates have lesser credit history, graduates are paying better than non-graduates, then you can give a formula saying when there is a graduate, there is a 90% chance that he will repay the loan, so then approve the loan. Those kind of heuristics you can find out based on all these things. Similarly, you can also do a variance test. In this case, I am not sure if variance test is appropriate. Yeah, in this case also you can say, are graduates having more variability in the income compared to non-graduates? That will help us identify some more buckets within graduates. Are you clear with these examples? How average, variance and proportion tests work?
Yes, Sandeep.
Okay. In future, we can also do, graduates versus gender versus graduates. Both are categorical columns in this case. We can do a comparison test between these two also. That I am not discussing right now, but we'll discuss right after ANOVA. Okay. We can do a test on two categorical variables also. Or you can do, are graduates self-employed? This is another question, right? How many graduates are self-employed? So you can do a test on these two categorical variables as well. So there are infinite possibilities. Are you clear so far?
Yes, Sandeep.
Okay. So I think let's close it today, because there is more to discuss and we don't have enough time. So I think it's better to break here. We'll close it now today. We'll continue tomorrow. Okay.
Okay.
Sure,
okay. Okay then. Yeah. Bye. Let's catch up tomorrow then.
Thanks, Sandeep.
Yeah. Okay. Bye.